Bill Porter movie on YouTube.
Door to Door.
With Helen Mirren.
Yeah. Incredible, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Powerful. Thanks for sharing that, Mark.
We'll remember you. Will you remember me? Don't let your life pass you by.
So with your permission, I want to have a conversation about something other than real estate today. Is that okay?
Sure.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Good. Good. Thank you, Sean. All right, so I just want to read a comment to you, and then I have a couple questions. Harboring anger and resentment for others, regardless of whether or not they deserve it, poisons your soul and limits your growth. How does that make you feel? How do you feel today? It's 9/11, 2020. It's been 19 years since the attack on the United States and the World Trade Centers. Are we in a better place today than we were 19 years ago?
Yes and no.
Is our country in a better place, or is our world in a better place today than it was 19 years ago?
No.
World filled with love, or for the most part, is there a lot of hate going on?
It's a lot. Definitely of hate.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't know. The hate is just louder.
Yeah, so here's the thing, guys. I know that there's going to be, and I'm hoping that there's going to be conversation around what I want to talk about today. So let's raise your hand. I want you to participate. I want to hear what you have to say. Do we judge based on parents? I'll give you a couple of examples, right? I support our country. I love the flag. I support our president. How does that make you feel? Last night at the opening of the NFL season, the Kansas City Chiefs played the Houston Texans, and the Texans sat for the national anthem. How does that make you feel? After the national anthem, both teams gathered together at the center of the field in a moment of unity to support everyone in our country, regardless of race, religion, and the fans booed. How does that make you feel?
It's not what the country's about. It's not what it was intended to be about. It's supposed to be that there's diversity, there's the ability to have civil protest, but the ability to come back together and understand that it's just to move the country and the experiment in democracy forward.
Thank you, Michael. Very well said. Valerie and then Sean.
Good morning, John. Our country.
Guys, if you're talking, it's very faint. I'm not sure if you've got a bad connection.
Uh-oh. Can you hear me any better?
It's a little better.
Crap.
Heard that. let me go to Sean, and I'm going to come back to you. By the way, I'm not using a headset for a reason. Can you guys hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. Let's go to Sean, and Valerie, I'll come back to you.
Do you feel like the NFL doesn't know what it's doing? They need to get out of the way. I mean, the fact that people are doing like unity, you know, what's meant to be a sign of togetherness is disturbing. But, you know, when I was trying to sell my last house, you know, there was just a million things that went wrong. And I was telling a coworker, and she said to me something interesting, you know, everything gets really difficult right before, you know, they try to pull you in right before you get out, you know? So when, you know, I look at all this stuff, I think the country is thrashing around a lot because we're trying to escape the throes of the past. You know, the things that are changing for the better. And the things that don't want that are agitating, but they really can't stop it from happening.
Well said. Thank you. Thank you for sharing, Sean. By the way, guys, let me share this with you. Last night was a sleepless night. It was a sleepless night because of a lot of reasons, and this conversation being one of them. And I understand at the same time that I'm opening a door that could lead to a result that I don't want. And here's what I know about this group. This group loves one another, supports one another. This is a community of growth and support. And I know that when I open the door and give you an opportunity to talk, it's going to be nothing but positive and nothing but love and support for one another. And that's why I'm doing this, because I have faith in you. Mariesta.
Okay. Thank you. Good morning, and John and everyone. I just want to, and thank you for the opportunity. I just want to say something. When you asked us about September 11, how we feel and how is the country, well, you can tell I am not originally from this country. I am from South America, Colombia. I have been in this country for 30 plus years. I am an American citizen, and because of my Colombian citizenship, I have the privilege to have dual citizenship. And I love this country. It took me 19 years to become an American citizen. And no matter what I have gone through, September 11, many, many things in my life here in the States, I always say when I am in America, I am an American. When I go to visit my family in Colombia, I am a Colombian. And I cannot tell you how much I love this country. Just when I became an American citizen was one of the happiest days of my life. And I still love, no matter what's going on with what we are seeing in this moment in the United States, I still love my United States, my country now. I don't know if you all remember when James Shaw apologized for a comment he made. I wanted to say something, but I just say, I let him say. But to me, yes, that comment was, I took it more like a joke, just as somebody was offended. I remember with my family, I had the chance at one point in my life, 20 years ago, to choose between to have the passport also for a Japanese passport because my father was Japanese. So I decided to, because I couldn't have three passports, just I decided to get the American passport. For me, it was going to be an honor to have the Japanese passport. In other words, in my family, at one point, they were talking that the American passport was being said that it didn't have the how much value, or it was more difficult to get in other countries. And it was kind of a friendly competition in my family, and there is members of my family who had the Colombian and Japanese. Anyway, what I'm saying is, I'm happy I have this opportunity to express my feelings, and I will never be offended for comments that somebody else makes. I don't take it personal, but I'm very happy for the opportunity, and I love everyone and this group and James Shaw's group, and it has been a blessing for me. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing. Very well said. And thank you for sharing that. Valerie, let's try you again.
I switched microphones. Is that
you're bad? Good. You're good.
And, you know, being an African-American, I've had a somewhat different experience in this country. That does not mean that I love it any less. I wake up every morning, just realizing that I have to be my best. Sometimes I do carry the weight of my race on my shoulders. I'm always striving to prove myself, shall we say. You know, and I think that what makes this country wonderful is its diversity and the stories that we all have that we can share with each other. You know, sadly enough, a lot of the things that have been happening lately, the positive side is now we're kind of sharing, even within Keller Williams, now we have equity and inclusion and a chance to talk and share our stories. You know, let's come from curiosity. When 9/11 happened, I was actually in Switzerland. And you talk about a different experience, man. You know, all of our colleagues looked at us Americans and said, oh, are you guys okay? And the next day, they were back to business as usual. I'd had to watch CNN to figure out what was going on. And, you know, the Europeans looked at us so differently than we look at each other. They were fascinated and curious about us because we were all different from them. You know, I wish that in this country we could somehow let our past experiences go. I actually learned myself about my preconceived notions because I was dealing with people who look like folks that I was used to dealing with, but they acted so differently. You know, we can learn a lot from the things that are happening right now and turn it into something positive.
Very well said, Valerie. Thank you for sharing that. Thank you. Clarissa.
Good morning.
Good morning, Clarissa.
So I'm like Valerie, person of color. So we've lived through this for our lifetime. And I equate what's going on in this country like a disease, whether it be cancer, heart disease. Where we are now is a symptom of whatever disease you want to call it that's plagued this country for years. For years. And sometimes, you don't realize you have that disease until you start to get symptoms. And something's not right. And it hasn't been right for so long. So now I equate the time that what we see now, we know that we have symptoms. It's being diagnosed right now. And sometimes once you get a diagnosis, you got to figure out what to do. And I think this country, in trying to figure out what we try to do, that comes in the form of revolutions. And believe it or not, if you want to admit it or not, we are going through a revolution. Civil rights was a revolution. We're going through a revolution now. And I believe that in the midst of us trying to treat our illness, we have to come from the vein. Are we going to treat it by continuing to be divisive, or are we going to treat it with trying to figure out equity for all?
Well said.
And I just get, you know, we can't slide. I didn't watch what happened last night, but I kind of got snippets. I don't do the news. But I kind of got snippets that, you know, the season was going to start and, you know, they were talking about, you know, how are we going to handle it? Are we going to stand for the, are we going to stand? Are we going to sit? And I think we have to get out of sliding people for the way that they're trying to deal with this disease, that treatment.
Agree.
I think as a country, we need to come together and say we need to treat it because it's a disease that's plagued us for many years and come to some form of equity. It's not going to go away unless we treat it.
Well said. Well said, Clarissa. Unless we get to the root and treat the root, it's not going to go away. We're so focused. If you're gardening and you have a plant that is not doing well, it's not going to do any good to treat the leaves and ignore the root. The problem is at the root. And when I ask you, how do you feel about this? It doesn't mean that I don't agree with something. I am simply raising emotions. And I want to, my goal here is to help you, is to get you to think and ask how you feel. How have you, does social media make this worse or does it make it better?
Worse.
Have any of you ever been unfairly judged? And how does that make you feel? You know, on 9/11/2001, horrible, right? 9/11/2001, I was in the fundraising business. I was not in the real estate business. And I worked with schools and nonprofit groups helping them raise money. And I was at an elementary school in Pinellas Park, Florida. I was talking to a group of elementary children. There was about 500 of them in the room. And it took a break between meetings because there's 1,000 kids in the school and we had like a 20-minute break. And I go look into the teacher's break room to get some coffee and the TV's on and I see a building on fire and I start to pay attention to what's going on. And then I get a call from my wife asking me, did you hear what happened? I'm like, no, I have no idea. My son at the time was 6 years old. Colin is 24 years old today. And he got on an airplane for the first time a year ago.
Oh, wow.
He would not fly out of fear. And I didn't think he would ever fly, right? And he got on a plane for the first time a year ago. My daughter was 6 months old, Lacey. And a lot of you know Lacey's stories because we've been friends for a long time. And you know that Lacey has had her fair share of adversity. She's 19 years old today. Today, when she was 14 years old, she was diagnosed with non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. And we went through 52 weeks of chemotherapy treatment with that little girl. And today she's a strong woman who has very strong opinions, right? Here, I'm gonna share my screen again. How does that make you feel?
That's now, pretty profound.
Here's what I know. There will be people who will judge her for that. There will be. There will be people who don't agree with that. By the way, that's okay. It is. And as a leader, and Corey knows this. The more successful you are, the higher you climb that leadership ladder, the more you're in the public eye, the more you are open for criticism and unfair judgment. And I don't care how high you climb that ladder or who you are, unfair judgment always hurts.
Well, John, unfair judgments makes me stronger, man.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It does make you stronger. Thank you, Corey.
It's part of the deal. It's part of the game. And it's sad, but we're gonna be judged any old way.
Here we are.
Corey, that's well said. And you're talking about being stronger. The challenge is while you're becoming stronger, just like a muscle, you get broken down first while you're becoming stronger. And that's the hard part. And that's where we have a challenge with media, the news, and social media, where you can go out there and say, hey, I'm for purple. And you're going to be a bunch of people that are going to rally around you and say, yay for purple. And then you're going to have some knuckleheads that are going to turn around and say, purple, why not pink? You're an idiot for thinking purple. And unfortunately, because of social media, that's where you're getting beat up, is that you have, instead of accepting, hey, you like purple, I like pink, yay, you have the people that are finding some way to tear you down.
Yeah.
The part, John, in this country right now.
John.
Yes, talk to me, Diane.
I just want to speak on behalf of all the youth, and I think the youngest person on this screen is probably Ryan, who is my daughter's age, 20 years old, who's Lacey's age. I just want you all to know that we are setting that example, and I just spent a few days with 10 young people in their 20s, and they don't feel like it's worth having children, a lot of them.
Yeah.
And they are looking up to us as their parents, as their mentors, as their leaders, as their educators to set that example. And so, yes, we all have to get along, you know, as peers, as coworkers, as society, as community, but we have to think about our children, our children's children. And even if you don't have children, you have to think about our future leaders. And that's, in their minds, they're not seeing the reason for, and that's why we're seeing a lot of unrest. And I can almost assure you, because three of these young people are Black who were with me, they asked the simple question. They asked me, they said, Diane or Mama Shu, have you ever walked in a store and felt uncomfortable because of the color of your skin? Mm-hmm. And I've been asked that before. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we have to do it for them. So that's all I got to say.
No, well said. And thank you for sharing that. And Ryan Pierre he's an incredible human being. I've only known this young man for a very short time. And from the very first time I met him, I told him how impressed I am with him. Mm-hmm. He is an incredible human being. Absolutely. Camille.
Yes. Hi. Good morning. You know, we've heard so much before. You said that we needed to actually identify and speak. I can't remember exactly how you said it, but you know, even at work, I'm with KW also. And you know, at work, you know, we form these groups to talk and no one wants to speak out and say exactly how they feel because they don't want to feel repercussion at work. And so how are we actually going to get this out? You know, I'm the only one who speaks up or knows that there's a problem with the country or something, you know, and I'm the one who speak up. And so the second meeting, I didn't go to it because people weren't really speaking out like they were supposed, you know, they were asking questions and they were like sidetracking everything and not wanting to say exactly how they felt, you know, so. How are we going to get to the root of the problem when we're afraid to speak out?
Well said, Camille. And you have to speak out anyways. Whether people agree with you or not, you have to speak out.
Thank you.
You have to. Pay attention to the people who appreciate you for who you are and ignore everything else.
Thank you.
100%. Mike Sweeney.
John, thank you, John. You know, I hate to harken back, and probably a lot of people never look at the album cover of Frank Zappa, but he basically had the toilet upstairs feeding the television. And that's what I think is really stoking division in our country. And you know, I've been told as a kid to stay away from the idiot box, and you know, I believed every print article, every radio and television article, and in social media to expound on it, really has divided this country. And yes, we have our issues, we have our past, but we are the most benevolent country that ever existed. And the proof is that they flock to our shores. And the one thing I was just looking at the other day was the Realtor's Code. And if we could always just go by what they've snuck in there is, you know, do unto others as you have do unto you. And it sounds so cliche, but you've been taught as a child to do that. And it's a shame that it takes a hurricane and sorts of stuff like that for everybody to come out of their houses and join and realize that we all bleed the same color and, you know, and we're all the same people. And I just, you know, I just think that when we look at what's going on TV and social media and print, it is not a reflection of what we are as human beings. Because when we see a car crash, when we see, you know, injustice in the streets, most of the time, we're there for each other. And I just wish that, you know, we can get away from the media part and the aspects of that. And I truly believe, as a benevolent country we are, that we all have a heart of gold if we look deep down inside.
Thank you, Mike, for sharing. I agree. And I appreciate what you said, and very well said too, again, by the way.
Hey, John, this is Fleur, and I'd like to share something.
Please. Hi, Fleur.
My name is Fleur Heaton. I'm a broker. I own my own company, and I'm grateful that I was invited into this group, and I love every minute since I joined.
We're glad to have you here.
Thank you. The other day, an agent said something very interesting to me. She said she was a listing agent. I showed her house. My buyers were rude, and she started explaining to me afterwards what was wrong with them. But anyway, she said she's got three things against her. Number one, she's a woman, and she's had denigrating comments about being a woman. Number two, she's Jewish, and she's heard a lot of anti-Semitism. And number three, she's blonde, and she's heard people say that she's not stupid, even though she's blonde. And I just thought to myself, I don't see those things against me. I take advantage of them, and I'm proud of them, because I've heard you say it over and over again. It's your attitude. I'm very proud to be a woman. I am a woman, so I take advantage of it. I use my femininity. I use my women skills, and sometimes I'll get my husband to give the masculine voice so that I can overcome chauvinism. That's number one. Number two, I'm Jewish, and I'm very proud to be Jewish, and I let it be known to customers, not flaunted, but if it comes up, I don't hide it. If somebody has a problem with that, it's their problem, not mine. And number three, I have salt and pepper hair, so I probably am judged by my age. I'm not blonde, but you know, my husband says that his wife is really blonde, but she colors her hair brunette. But it's just a joke. So I take advantage of the things that I have. I'm not saying it's always easy, but I look at it as nothing against me. I take advantage, and I'm fully aware of it, and I'm proud of it. Thank you.
Love that. Thank you for sharing. And guys, believe it or not, it's already 8:35. So I want to close with this. I want to share some thoughts on forgiveness. I will greet this day with a forgiving spirit. At this moment, my life has taken on new hope and assurance. Of all the world's population, I am one of the few possessors of the secret to dissipating anger and resentment. I now understand that forgiveness only has value when it is given away. By the simple act of granting forgiveness, I release the demons of the past about which I can do nothing, and create in myself a new heart and a new beginning. I will greet this day with a forgiving spirit. I will forgive even those who do not ask for forgiveness. Many are the times when I have seethed in anger at a word or deed thrown into my life by an unthinking or uncaring person. I will now and forever silently offer my forgiveness even to those who do not see that they need it. By the act of forgiving, I am no longer consumed by unproductive thoughts. My bitterness is given up. I am contented in my soul and effective again with my fellow man. I will greet this day with a forgiving spirit. I will forgive those who critique me unjustly. Neither misguided opinion or unjust criticism will alter my course. Criticism is part of the price paid for leaping past mediocrity. I will greet this day with a forgiving spirit. I will forgive myself. For many years, my greatest enemy has been myself. Every mistake, every miscalculation, every stumble I made has been replayed over and over in my mind. Every broken promise, every day wasted, every goal not reached has compounded the disgust I feel for the lack of achievement in my life. My dismay has developed a paralyzing grip. I realize today that it is impossible to fight an enemy living in my head. By forgiving myself, I erase the doubt, fear, and frustration that have kept my past in the present. From this day forward, my history will cease to control my destiny.
Thank you, John. I love that.
Thank you, John. Beautiful.
Thank you.
Thank you, John.
And thank you for doing this.
Thank you, everyone, for being here. Really, it was great to hear everyone's opinion. And it actually really sinks in. Thanks.
Yeah. I agree.
Thank you so much.
I agree.
Have a good day, guys.
Make it a great day.